Good morning, everyone. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening. Really trying to hit all the time zones here. But we definitely want to welcome you to today's workshop for social media basics for educators. So sit back, get comfortable, and definitely enjoy the following presentation from two social media mavens. First, a bit of logistics. In this session, if you have any questions, please feel free to type them in your text chat to your left. I will make sure that the speakers get the questions to them and they are asked during the presentation. You may also notice poll questions during the session today, so please take time to answer them so we can really get a feel for the room. First off, I want to encourage you to think about maybe expanding your personal learning community. Many of you are part of the Catalyst group, but I don't know if you're aware, we just opened up membership to the NMC for individuals involved in K-12 education. So for just $99 a year, the NMC's K-12 membership will give you many opportunities to learn from educational and industry thought leaders, participate in professional development, and engage with other members that work in K-12, universities, libraries, and museums. NMC members do have access to a broad and growing catalog of research-based publications that really document and analyze the global landscape for emerging technologies, trends, challenges, and new learning approaches. So come September, the NMC Commons will also provide members with a myriad of ways to share ideas and resources to connect with each other and to explore the creative and professional interests. Also, this presentation will be available for download on SlideShare, which we will provide the link to you a little bit later in the session. But now on to the stars of the show, Samantha Adams and Rebecca Otis. Samantha Adams is the Director of Communications for the NMC, where one of her favorite tasks is to leverage and experiment with social media on a daily basis. In her previous life, she was managing editor of a magazine and then at the forefront of the digital strategy and digital communications for several major publishing companies. Nowadays, Samantha strives to bring the NMC's diverse projects, events, and publications to as many audiences as possible in an approachable format across social media platforms. She applies this to her work with the HP Catalyst Initiative to broaden the reach of its projects. Sam attended the University of Texas, focusing her studies on honors English. She has a diverse background from publishing a book to sitting on the board for the Austin Poetry Society. Samantha also writes for the New Orleans Magazine, is involved in several other writing projects around the country. You're very lucky to have Samantha on our team at the NMC. I know I certainly feel that. Rebecca Otis is the founder of the Recommendations, an award-winning entertainment blog, and LocalizeAustin, a local business consultancy connecting Austin-based small business with the people, ideas, and resources they need to grow, promote, and get noticed. Recently, she served as the social media administrator for Texas.gov, the official website for the state of Texas. In this role, she developed a leading-edge social media strategy that is used as a model for governments statewide and across the country. Through her work at LocalizeAustin, Rebecca has spearheaded the marketing and public relations effort for three Austin autism initiatives, securing media coverage on local and national media outlets. This work has inspired her to continue to build autism advocacy and raise support and funds for those who are impacted by autism spectrum disorder, through FAIR and otherwise. Rebecca has lived in Austin for 9 years, has a bachelor in business administration and marketing from the McCombs School of Business at the University of Texas at Austin. She is a member of the Austin Young Chamber of Commerce, Austin Independent Business Alliance, Better Bites of Austin, and is the secretary of the Social Media Club of Austin and social chair of the Austin Food Blogger Alliance Board. And I see that Jim is throwing some links in to the text chat as well, talking about autism. So I want to welcome everybody today, and we're certainly excited to have you here and really just sharing out what you're doing, and I'm going to go ahead and turn it over to Sam.
Welcome so much. I'm so glad that you're here. I'm excited to be talking to you today about a really important subject, which is social media basics for educators. So how this workshop came about is I had a blast getting to know a bunch of the HP Catalyst members in Beijing at the HP Catalyst Summit back in April. And a lot of you had questions about how to boost project visibility and leverage social media. So now we're here, and we're going to make that happen for you. First, before we delve into the content, I want to say a little thank you, or a big thank you, rather, to HP's Office of Sustainability and Social Innovation who makes the HB Catalyst Initiative possible, along with this series of workshops. So big virtual round of applause for HP. Woo! Awesome. Okay. So what are we talking about today? I know you received a lot of emails about what the event was going to be about, but let's get down to brass tacks. We're talking about defining your goals, building a solid social media identity, leveraging your audiences, setting up Facebook and Twitter pages, creating, finding, and sharing the most effective content, connecting with your communities, both local and global, and centralizing your social media platforms to make your life a bit easier. So we've been talking about social media identity and all the promotions leading up to this workshop, but what does that really mean? What makes up a social identity? Well, you'll see how all that really means is goals, audience, inspiration, and voice. Those are the important components that make up an identity, so we'll be hitting on how to come up with each one of those. So first things up, listen up. So social media is, in a lot of ways, all about putting content out there and talking. But the most important thing you can do in social media, even before you start to build your pages, is listen. Listen to people out there on social media who you follow, but most importantly at the beginning, listen to the people that you're working with. So before we started, when we were starting to put together this workshop, we really wanted to make sure that it was tailored to your specific needs. So what we did, as many of you know, especially you HB Catalyst members, is we put out a survey to the HB Catalyst community to find out how they're using social media, what sites they were frequenting, and what they wanted to get out of a workshop. So the results were in, and it was very, very clear that Twitter, Facebook, and YouTube are the most commonly used social media sites amongst HB Catalyst members, which isn't a big shocker because that's pretty much the way the rest of the world is trending. The second question we asked is, how are you currently using social media tools? Well, we got an overwhelming response that it was to learn about other organizations and projects, which is exciting because once you build your Facebook pages, there's a whole group of people out there who are looking to learn about organizations just like you. And the final question that we asked is, what do you want to get out of this workshop? And we got a bunch of really interesting responses, but the main ones were building a solid social media identity and boosting project visibility, as well as learning what content to share and where to share it. So you're in luck. We're going to be talking about all those things. So why is this important other than determining what you want to get out of this workshop? Well, it's important because when you're building a social media page, you want to start by formulating questions and gathering data. Maybe start a focus group that includes your colleagues, some of your friends, and people close to the project. Get a sense of what they'd want to get out of a social media page about your project. Gather that data, ask people out, ask people via email, ask people if you have a personal Twitter or Facebook account, by using the Facebook polling feature, by using specific hashtags, which we'll get into more a little later on Twitter. But just make sure you're getting multiple perspectives. So next, after you've asked questions and done some data gathering and feel like you have a well-rounded perspective on what everyone in your project team really wants to get out of the experience, it's time to sit down and define your goals. So really, before you do anything, you're going to want to define your goals. Two HB Catalyst project leaders, Tanya Lovejoy and Lisa Koster, were gracious enough to volunteer to share their projects with us as examples, which is really exciting. So thank you, Tonya, and thank you, Lisa. I know that you're both in the audience right now. So thank you, thank you, thank you. So it's important to note at the outset that both their projects are in different stages and are inherently very different from each other. So as a result, their goals are different. And that's how it should be. Tonya manages the Reach the World project from New York and the New Learner Consortium. Using HP technology, Reach the World has connected students learning STEM subjects and mentors from all over the world who are studying abroad. These connections are making STEM learning much more engaging. On the other hand, Lisa is creating an engaging and collaborative environment focused on helping students to relate their learning experience to real business applications. business math lab, which includes 45 HP Elite tablets, an interactive whiteboard, and the use of online learning tools, video, and collaborative software are serving as a cornerstone of this project. And Lisa, again, manages the business math project as part of the STEMpreneur Consortium. So right off the bat, Tonya is working with an organization, while Lisa is working with a college. That in of itself should signify a difference in goals. For example, as you'll see from Tonya's goals, as a learning-focused organization, branding is actually really important. But as a college project like Lisa has, branding isn't so much of critical importance. It's more about sharing resources with other educators as a top priority. So your goals will inform and shape your identity on social media as well as the content you share. Rebecca will visit these projects and goals later in the workshop to show how each project mentioned can actually take one step further and accomplish them. So, okay, you have your goals. You have a list you're sure of. You feel good about it. Next up, it's time to identify who your audiences are. This is critical. There are usually multiple people who you want to target, and that can get a little stressful because you can't please everyone in one post sometimes. In the case of the HB Catalyst projects and other academic projects, it may and usually does come down to wanting to reach other educators from across the globe, community volunteers, students, and of course, potential project investors or funders. So first things first, if you've created your account or if you have a personal account, make sure to start following these people. So if there's a super cool organization that's doing something that's similar to what you're doing, follow them. If there is an organization that's giving out grants that may fit in with the project that you're working on, follow them. Potential educators that could get involved in your project or may want to launch similar things, start following them. Just make sure to always keep your audience in the back of your mind when building your social media pages and sharing your content. For example, if once you have your Facebook page up and you're making a post that's calling for community volunteers to help facilitate a gaming workshop, you might want to think about sharing a resource in the afternoon that could help other educators develop similar projects. So like I mentioned earlier, one post may not capture every single audience. Just make sure that you frequently share posts that, you know, really connect with one of your audiences. And so I had given an example about community volunteers. So in terms of potential funders, frequent updates on how your project is going is key. So an idea, maybe take a 1 minute video on your smartphone of a planning meeting in action and share it on Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube. Create a photo album of the students engaged in the project and add to it regularly. Make sure your captions are short, but explain what they're working on. But as you all know, in grants, a lot of what you're doing is trying to help potential funders visualize your project. Social media is your visual evidence. I guess think of it as a collection of your project artifacts. So back to community volunteers. Finding volunteers is a lot easier when a prospective volunteer could see your project. If you're posting about the need for volunteers, post it with a picture of previous volunteers in action and state how much was accomplished. An example might be looking for volunteers to coordinate a gaming workshop for just a few hours a week. At our last workshop, they really made the students stay and helped their project grow considerably. And definitely share a photo of that last workshop in action so people could visualize what they're getting into. So we've talked about establishing goals and audience. It's time to start applying those goals just a bit. And so I have my alma mater, University of Texas at Austin, Hook'em, up there right now. Not just because I'm an alumna, but because I really follow their page and enjoy what they're doing. And this is a really important step. You could start applying your goals by finding organizations who have similar ones. At the NMC, I look to other academic institutions and organizations all the time to see what they're doing with social media. If something's working well for them, there's a good chance it could for us. You could then find a way to make it your own, in my case, NMC-ify it, and make it applicable to other audiences. So like I said, UT does a great job posting campus news and highlights, and I often look to them for inspiration. Okay, so the next component we're going to talk about is voice. It's really critical, really critical part of building your social media identity to have a clear and solid voice that people could recognize. You don't want to vary it up too much because it starts to confuse people about who you are. For example, if every post is completely humorous and it's all jokes, people may not take your page seriously. However, if you're completely professional and keep it academic, a joke every now and then or a funny comic that pertains to educational technology, might be a breath of fresh air and really entice people. Something to know about speaking and your voice on social media is that we know academic speak is formal. No one on Facebook or Twitter, though, wants to read a grant proposal. People are normally looking for a voice that is, above all else, concise, approachable, and easy to understand. Be professional, but be colloquial. And above all else, be a human being. Also, another really important thing to remember is to always give people credit. So in this example, it's a post from the NMC. And it was a great article outlining some of the most fantastic EdTech research projects happening across the world. And four of those projects happened to come out of NMC member institutions, which is fantastic. Well, you want to, when you're announcing that, excitedly, you want to make the members or your audience, the people mentioned in the article, feel like, you're really proud of them and give them the credit. And so there's ways to tag them in that Facebook post, so it'll show up on their newsfeed and on their wall as well. And that way, everyone is all connected, and you're giving credit where credit is due. In that moment, you're engaging a ton of other people, because if your post is tagging Brown University, for example, it's going to show up on Brown University's wall, and the hundreds of thousands of Brown University followers will see that post. And your name will be out there. The NMC brand will be out there further. Okay, another really important thing to talk about that people start to feel sometimes a little bit uncomfortable about is eavesdropping. So normally in other social situations in person, you might not feel that comfortable listening in on people's conversations. You don't want to be necessarily creeping in the background, right? But social media creates a comfortable environment to do just that in. So maybe even before you create your Twitter account, if that's seeming a little bit daunting to you and you'd rather just take some time and see what else is out there, I highly recommend going to twitterfall.com, which is a browser-based tool, and getting started there. What that tool allows you to do is type in any keywords, hashtags, usernames that you're aware of, that you follow, that you really like, and kind of eavesdrop on conversations. So following people and interacting with them increases your chances of being followed back and building your community. Eavesdropping on hashtag conversations that are relevant to you will give you a better understanding of how your audience is using Twitter and what issues they care about. And using those hashtags allows you to enter that conversation and the people involved start keeping tabs on you. Make a list of hashtags and people and organizations that are relevant to you, maybe in a Google Doc or in a place where you could update it regularly, and make sure to be entering them in your Twitter fall. So that brings us to a really important subject of hashtags. So what is a hashtag? I know it's tossed around a lot, and some of you may know exactly what a hashtag is, and that's great. I've seen a ton of people using the HB Catalyst hashtag, for example. Which is wonderful, and there's an HP Catalyst back channel conversation taking place on Twitter right now. If you put the pound sign or that number sign before a word, such as STEM or e-learning or HP Catalyst or EdTech, that becomes a hyperlink to a conversation that's already unfolding about EdTech. Someone else has referenced something, EdTech or STEM or e-learning, for example. So hashtags are key. Okay, so that actually brings us to Rebecca Otis, our next speaker. But at this time, I want to open the floor to see if anyone has any questions so far at this point. Okay, I see. What's a good way to find hashtags that are already in popular use? That's a great question, Jim. A great way to do that is simply by searching, because they're updated so regularly. Websites search best education hashtags, literally in your Google, Yahoo, being whatever search tool you use, if you search it in there, there's going to be a tremendous amount of articles that pop up. But off the top of my head, probably the hashtags the NMC most commonly uses when tweeting, because it relates a lot to our audience, is hashtag EdTech, hashtag EdChat, hashtag STEM, and of course hashtag HB Catalyst. All right, fantastic. I hope that everyone feels comfortable asking questions as this workshop goes along. We're going to stop at various points so that we could answer them. So keep them coming. All right, next up, it's my pleasure to introduce social media guru and my dear friend, Rebecca Otis, the founder of Localize Austin.
Thank you so much for having me. It's been a pleasure. I have collaborated with the NMC and with Samantha before. We spoke together at the National University Technology Network Conference. Hopefully I got that acronym correct. And I really enjoyed getting to know some of the HP Catalyst projects as I prepared for today's webinar. So please go ahead and ask any questions that you have as we go along, and I'll try to address them. So we talked a lot about setting up your social media strategy, or Samantha did. So now we're going to go ahead and talk about content. There's a popular question, which is always, what do I share? How do I get information to share? Sometimes I don't know what to say. And my answer to that is that there's probably a lot more that you knew you could share that people will find interesting, even if it's just basic information about your organization, that someone, maybe a new Facebook follower and didn't know that. They're kind of coming in fresh and new, and so maybe they just didn't know that. So even going back to the basics and sharing some of your basic information is never old. It can also be a reminder for those of your followers who have been loyal if you have a longer-term following. So here are just some ideas of things that you can share. So if you think maybe you don't have content, the reality is you probably do. Any kind of news, if you have media alert, if your project has been recognized, that is, you know, kind of a no-brainer that your audience would probably want to know that. And it can be great to highlight whatever media or publication, media source or publication that highlighted your project, and possibly they'll share it to their larger audience of followers. Announcements, events, milestones, if you reach a new milestone in terms of funding, or even if you just get to a big number of followers on your social media channels and that's a big milestone for you, then maybe you celebrate that and share it publicly. Photos of your project, I think, for me personally, as a consumer and as a lifetime learner, just learning about behind the scenes of what's happening in your project. As Samantha mentioned, maybe it's just, you know, a photo of your planning meeting. Anything that you can share behind the scenes kind of makes your audience feel like they're an exclusive follower and that they get kind of a sneak peek into what's happening behind the curtain. Video clips can be really successful, and I think a common misunderstanding that I come across is that an organization may think that producing a video is costly and complicated, when really, as Samantha mentioned, you can take a quick video update on your smartphone or your webcam on your laptop or your computer, and that can serve as video. And multimedia is a big plus because it drives attention to the eye, and anything that can stand out in the world of lots of social media content will give you a leg up so that someone may, you know, click your post and get to your page and subsequently hopefully back to your website to learn more about what you do. Media coverage, as I mentioned, giveaways are popular, a popular way to engage your audience and bring in some new audience members. People like incentives. We all like a good deal or a good sale. And so any kind of giveaway is a great way to spread the word, and your audience may spread it for you. Trivia, I think, is always fun. If you can ask your audience trivia questions, you know, I think it could be a fun way to engage the audience and see who can answer first or who can answer correctly. Contest surveys. So as we mentioned, we put out a survey to see what all of you wanted to hear about in today's webinar. And so a survey is almost one of the best things about social media that we didn't have in traditional marketing, that was not two-way or multi-directional. It was just one-way communication. If you got a piece of direct mail, or if you were looking at an ad on TV or hearing one on the radio, you didn't have that option to provide your own feedback. And so with social media, That's surveys and asking feedback of your audience is one of the best ways, I think, to use it and garner feedback from your audience. And then you can cater directly to what they're wanting, and then everybody's happier in theory. And then news about partners and contributors. I don't mean to put that last in the list. I think it's actually very significant, and another really, really important way that we can use social media is to highlight the people that believe in what you do. And everyone likes a little nod or a little attention every once in a while. It makes them feel good. It's just like giving a compliment. And so on social media, I think one of the biggest ways that you can help grow your audience and build relationships really online is by talking about your partners in a positive way, sharing their news, and then contributors as well to your organization. So we're talking about content creation, so we're going to go ahead and talk about the two examples that Samantha prefaced in the beginning. So Reach the World is a really incredible organization that I came across when I was preparing today. And so one of the questions that I think all of us can ask ourselves when we're looking at social media, as I mentioned, is how do we find and create content? But not only content, but content that is compelling for your audience. How do you get that like or get someone to really be interested in what you're doing? And so the first thing that I would mention is searching for relevant organizations when you're in your social media page. So whether it's Twitter or Facebook, we'll use Facebook here as an example. So if you have set up your social media page for your project, or if you're going to, one of the first things that I typically do when I start a page is start searching, whether it's through Google first to find their Facebook page or whether through Facebook specifically, and look for organizations that are related to what your project does. It may not be directly related, but a group that you may be interested in knowing what they're doing, they may be interested in what you're doing. And so in this example, you can see on the left side, when you have an organization or business page, you have the opportunity to like other organizations and businesses from your business page. And so here you can see that Reach the World has liked Teach for America. I think it has very similar qualities in that they both mobilize volunteers or employees or ambassadors all around the world in different geographic locations. And their sole purpose is to better that, whether it's a school, an educational organization, their goal is to better the lives of those who are involved. And so they like Teach for America because they have very similar qualities. And so once you like these pages, then it's easy to keep up with what they're doing and even get ideas about how they're using social media, as Samantha mentioned. So then if you look to the right here, we can see Reach for the World then was already tapped into Teach for America on Facebook. And therefore, it was simple for them to share simple news from Teach for America's Facebook page. And it publishes to the Reach the World Facebook page. And so that's an example of sharing news about your partners or organizations that may be related to what you do. And so the first step is when you create your Facebook page and even your Twitter page, and I would venture out into the world of Google Plus as well, it's recommended that you go in and search for organizations and like them, and then it's easy to keep up with their news, and then you have content to share with your audience. So how else can we find and create compelling content? Your community. So those that are participating in your project, let them help provide you with content. So maybe you send out an email asking for stories, and then you share them on Facebook or on a blog if you have one. Or maybe you even share it in your next newsletter. So ask your community. Use your community. And so the left example shows that Reach the World actually was sharing a post that one of their travel correspondents wrote. I'll touch on another step, I think, in the subsequent slide. And then on the right side, you'll see just kind of a fun post, which, as Samantha mentioned, you know, people always like a good laugh, always like to participate in a good fun conversation. And so in this instance, really, it was just a matter of being creative and thinking, okay, we have an audience of individuals who explore the world in different geographic locations, and by the way, they make a difference while they're doing it. So maybe our audience is really interested in traveling, and maybe they have an imagination, and for example, Survivor may be their favorite TV show, but hey, let's just ask them if they were stranded on an island, what three items would they need to have with them. And that's purely fun and just a great way to keep everyone engaged. It doesn't always have to be informative. Also, any internal news, information, communications, anytime you have a message that you need to get out, one of the purposes of building that audience is then you have someone to distribute that information to. And so here's a simple way that you can cross-promote different marketing channels. And so when you have a newsletter that you're sending out to your audience, simply post it on your other social media channels, such as Facebook. You can also link to it in Twitter, maybe even Google+, and any other social media channels that you prefer. You could give an intro to it on YouTube if you wanted to get fancy. But here, simply just sharing your newsletter to your Facebook audience. And I personally prefer also to share a link where they can subscribe to the newsletter, just in case they missed it or they weren't subscribed yet, but they really liked what content you had shared in the most recent newsletter. So consider adding a link to lead them to subscribe and give them a preview of what they could get in the future. So Reach the World had sent us some goals and some questions, and so we're going to talk about, they're doing some really great things with social media, as we can see. I was personally impressed. So let's just talk about how we could take it one step further, and hopefully this will answer some of their questions or really just provide some ideas. Some of their goals, as we mentioned, is the first step in social media strategizing is establishing goals. So their three goals were to connect their volunteers with each other, to increase brand recognition and therefore site traffic, and to promote intercultural awareness and geographic literacy. And the last piece was build credibility and recognition of expertise in their field. So let's go through. All right, so the first one, to connect our talented and dedicated volunteers with each other. Well, how can they do that? Through social media. Here are just a few ways that we came up with. The first would be potentially hosting participant webinars, if I'm not sure that you do this yet or not, or Google+ Hangouts. I personally am a big fan of Google+ Hangouts. I think they're a very low cost and fun way to engage with more than one person. And so that would be a really great way to get the volunteers engaged. They could all meet each other, even if they're across the world, and therefore you could keep them connected. You could create Twitter lists. So if you follow your participants on Twitter, you could create a list of your volunteers and maybe each volunteer class. And then the volunteers could find each other, and anyone who's interested in your project could also easily find those groups of individuals and follow them too. And the third idea would be to share stories from volunteers in similar geographic locations or to group content. So if someone, you know, in one country has tips on eating healthy while they're working in a different country, and another volunteer has the same idea, but it's a completely different cuisine, and then maybe you can group content in that way and keep volunteers and your audience connected in that way. So the second goal is to increase brand recognition and site traffic. And so here are some ideas that we came up with. I don't know that I came across a blog, but there may be one for the project that exists. If not, I would highly recommend having a blog, because I think it can build a lot of traffic to your website. So if you post a link to a blog post on Facebook, then if someone clicks on it, they're going to go back to your website, and then they might search around for other information about what you do, and they may become engaged or involved. And so on the blog, you could ask participants or guest contributors to write a blog post for you. So in that instance, you don't actually have to generate the content yourself. All you have to do is reach out to those who you'd like to help create that content, and then post it and share it for your audience. And then also that individual will get some extra attention, and everyone, you know, likes to be recognized. Also, you could post questions on social media channels, and then post the answer on the blog or on your website. And that way you're drawing someone in on a social channel, and then you're leading them to your website to get more traffic. Reach the World mentioned that they had some troubles, which always happens with technical platforms, and there were some video troubles, but video can be really effective here if there's a good solution for you, whether you choose to use Vimeo or another video source. I think they mentioned that YouTube was not allowed in certain schools, so that was a barrier. But if you can find a way to share video, or even do live conversations that others can tap into, like we're doing today, I think Skype interviews or live chats with volunteers around the world would be a really interesting conversation. I personally would like to learn about that and hear from those who are mobilized in different areas of the world. And you could post these events or these videos on your website. And if you have an event calendar on your site, and you also hopefully have volunteer applications on your website, then you can use social media channels to drive your audience back to your site. And then another thing that I've been recommending recently is if you have photos that maybe you could put your project or the Reach the World logo or icon or even just the words, if you have a graphics extraordinaire or someone who's familiar with graphics in your organization, to add that logo to the photos before you post them to social media. And that way, if you post them to Facebook, for example, and someone in your audience shares it, then the person who sees it next will see that it came from Reach the World. And that's a way to grow your brand presence beyond just the audience that you have now. So consider adding the Reach the World, the words or the logo to any videos, any photos that you have produced. And that way, if others are sharing it for you, then that message may get a little bit further than it would have before. The third goal would be to promote intercultural awareness and geographic literacy. The second part, build credibility and recognition of expertise in the field. And so here are a few ideas. One is to connect with geographers and possibly host a live Twitter chat if they happen to be active on Twitter or even on Facebook. I've seen where you can, you know, set up an event for your audience and say, Tuesday at 10, we're going to have a live chat with a geographer and he's going to tell us all about the landscape in this particular country. And by the way, we're going to have a volunteer chime in that's placed in that country at this time. And so what you would do is you would set it up and maybe you're alongside them or maybe you're on the phone with them as well, or you provide them instructions beforehand, but they're live on your page and the audience can chime in with questions and they can answer live. The second idea is to post volunteer, excuse me, I have to back up a little bit. Reach the World mentioned that they have just solidified, I hope this is public information, a new partnership with a publication such as National Geographic. And I think that's a really great way to share information and that's huge credibility booster for the project. And so posting those volunteer articles on social media channels would be a really great way to boost knowledge, engagement, boost an audience, boost your audience. And I think you can definitely capitalize on that. Make sure if you're posting about it that you're tagging National Geographic or mentioning them with Twitter would be with the at symbol before the National Geographic Twitter name and on Facebook, tagging the National Geographic and potentially posting to their wall as well whenever you're sharing those articles so that hopefully their audience will see it and they will share it with even more people than you could have shared on your own. And the third idea would be potentially to host a contest for volunteers to maybe take and post photos of pictures with national or state officials in their location. I think that builds credibility and recognition of the program and shows that they're interfacing with you know, individuals in their city or the country that they're traveling to and may actually get some new eyes on it. So those were just a couple ideas. Of course, you can get creative and there's certain things that are feasible and certain things that are not. But take those for what they are and hopefully you can modify them or use some of those ideas for your own organization. So we're going to go through one more example, and this is the business math project at Conestoga College. I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly. The three goals were to increase visibility, to make connections with other educators who do similar things, so building awareness around math, and then encourage entrepreneurs from around the world to take part in the project and share how they use math with students. And that's a really specific goal, and I think that's a really great one to identify. So the first one, make connections with other educators. So to this I say the power of Google should never be underestimated. I use Google a lot to search for Facebook or Twitter pages for different organizations. Sometimes it's not as in, the name of the page is not as intuitive as I would like it to be if I'm searching in Facebook or Twitter. So Google will usually lead me there if they have one. And so here I just did a quick search for college math programs Facebook. And the first link that you'll see wasn't a Facebook result, but it showed what the best mathematic programs in the U.S. were. And so therefore, you could go research that list and see if they had Facebook pages, potentially even just interface with the university main page and recognize, we realize that you're recognized as one of the best mathematics programs. We'd like to share with you what we're doing. And the second search result, you'll see there that, for example, Queens College, Division of Math and Natural Sciences, they have a specific Facebook page for their math school. So there's a page that you could follow and engage with. The second goal is encourage entrepreneurs from around the world to take part in the project and share how they use math with students. And so here, again, Google can be a really great resource. And so you can look for mathematics Twitter users. And so here I found that there was a list that you could look at and follow mathematicians. And then secondly, on Facebook, I know here in Austin we have the Texas Entrepreneur Network, but you could search for other entrepreneur networks, possibly post to their wall and mention to them, we have a challenge for you. We're looking for mathematics professionals or entrepreneurs that have used math to create something to share these stories with our audience. We'd love for you to post this on our page, or we'd love you to be a contributor for our blog, for example. And so let's talk about content and tools and what kinds of content you can post to different tools. Here we just talk about Facebook and Twitter, although I acknowledge that there are several other tools that can be used. You can post the same content, just recognize that the format varies per tool. So I agree that it can be very effective, and I don't believe that it's always redundant to share the same information on Facebook and Twitter and possibly Google+. That being said, I think it's important to format that message for the tool. And so here I've provided a simple table to show that if you wanted to post an event on Facebook, they actually have an event feature where you can create what they call an event. You provide the date, the calendar day and time, the location. Sometimes it provides a map, I believe, or at least tags that location. And you can invite individuals or post it to your page. And on Twitter, in that instance, you would likely have to either post a link to the Facebook event, or you could post just the details or post a link to the event details on your website. Polls, for example, if you wanted to survey your audience, Facebook has a poll feature. I haven't seen one yet on Twitter. If it's there, I'd love to hear about it. But on Twitter, you could definitely just ask a question to your audience and see if you get feedback. And videos on Facebook, there is an area where you can post videos. I believe you can actually also record videos that will be updated directly to YouTube from your webcam on Facebook. And then Twitter, you would post a link to the video. And photos, Facebook definitely has a place where you can share photos. It's quite popular. And on Twitter, there is a way that you can also attach a photo. So this is just an example of how you can share the same content, but just acknowledge that it's going to be in a different format for each tool. Twitter polls do exist, I am seeing in the chat window. Fabulous. I cannot wait to use that. All right. So here we talk about, if we're still talking about how do we find content, and here I would say reused content is encouraged. It's okay to cross-post content on different tools and to share content that has been shared by someone else, as long as you give credit where it's due. So here we're going to talk about internal cross-posting. As we mentioned, you can post different information or the same information across tools. So for example, if you set up a Facebook event, you can share it on Twitter, your blog, you could talk about it on a YouTube video to get people excited. You could mention it on Google+. They do have an events feature on Google+. So if you post it to all of them, you'll get more eyes, ears, and attendees. And different audience members prefer to use different channels, so you will likely reach different people on different tools. Of course, there may be your super fans who are following you across all of those channels, but all the more reason to reemphasize the importance of that event, and hopefully you'll get them as an attendee. You can reach different audiences, as I mentioned, and just again to acknowledge a different makeup of content, a video promotion of an event versus a Facebook event link or an event graphic, which would be a photo. And so cross-posting externally, I think, is also encouraged, meaning partners, collaborators, participants, they like to be acknowledged and valued. Reshare their content and give them a little, you know, a little nod here or there. And I think that they'll appreciate it. Likely they will share it, or hopefully they will, with their audience, or even thank you for acknowledging it. And that can be a really great way to build relationships, especially with organizations that you want to connect with but haven't been able to yet. Sharing their information may get their attention, and then maybe you'll build a new relationship. And of course, I underline to make sure that you're citing your source appropriately. If you share a link, make sure that you acknowledge where it came from. If you share a photo, the same thing. This is a, you know, social media is a relatively new form of communication, but the same rules apply to whether you were quoting someone in a text case study. So this is a lot of content. We're creating things to share with our audience, but more than anything, we want them to be results driven. We want them to achieve the end goal or the end goals that we defined at the beginning. And we want it to be audience focused. So how do I post for maximum return? Well, this is one, I guess, rule tip that I live by, and I would say maybe the secret potion, but really something just to keep in mind is when you're posting, I like to include a minimum of one of these things. If I can use more of them, all the better. It gives your audience one more potential reason to engage with your link or your information that you're sharing on social media channels. So a link, a tag, which means linking to that Facebook page from Facebook, or tagging someone in Twitter, and then a photo and a video. So if you were to have all four of those things, if it was relevant to your message, there's a more likely chance that someone will see it and engage with it. Maybe the video caught their eye, maybe they clicked the link, maybe they saw the tag on the other organization's page. So think about these things when you're posting and how you can maximize the return on each post that you post. And so here are some examples. So here's one tweet that we saw from Reach the World, and they include a link in it, so that's great. So I tried to think of one more way that we could optimize this post. And so you'll see here that we include a hashtag before education and a hashtag before technology. And again, those hashtags are keywords that other people around the world may be searching for. And hashtags can be really effective because if you have an audience of 200 people, only those 200 people may come across your tweet or your Twitter message. However, if you use a hashtag or a keyword like education or technology that is relatively general, someone that's across the world that is not a follower yet may be looking up Twitter messages about education. And they may come across your page, they may click on your tweet, they may click on the link, end up on your page and realize they have really great content, I want to follow them too. If you're trying to reach other followers other than who you already have, which I think probably would be a goal of many of us, then hashtags could be a really effective way to do that. And I personally believe that knowing which hashtags are popular in your industry and then also using hashtags that are relatively general is a good rule of thumb because it's a good chance someone else is looking for hashtag education also. One other note, in this tweet, I'm not sure how many characters are in it, but if you're approaching the 140 character limit, hashtag EDU and hashtag tech would also be a really great way to tag those keywords and get other followers and also save some characters. And then here are two other tweets. One's from HP. You can see they tag National Geographic, they have a hashtag for sustainable, and they have a link. So therefore, National Geographic may retweet it. Someone across the world looking for sustainable tweets may find it. And someone who's already your audience may find this really interesting and click on the link and continue to be a loyal follower. So there's an example of a tweet that has three different ways that someone could interact with your message and potentially grow your audience. And then the third one is New Media Consortium tweet here. They use STEM as a hashtag, and then they use Khan Academy, tagging them. And then they have a link, and then they have two other hashtags. So there are a lot of opportunities in this message for others to find it and engage with it. So it's somewhat of a new different way of thinking when you're writing on social media because you do have to think of strategy in mind. And so this is a new way that hopefully will benefit you if you're not thinking this way already. You have something to share. That's fabulous. But how can we make it even more fabulous and more results driven? How can we plug in keywords? How can we tag a resource or tag a publication that's relevant and try to get someone to interact with the information that we're sharing? Correct. Samantha mentioned you don't need a tweet full of hashtags, but if it does enhance your message, that would be recommended. And here are two other examples. Here's a Facebook post from the New Media Consortium. And again, it looks like I'm highlighting and trying to plug in too many of these things, but really I'm just looking at it with that eye. So here's a post from the New Media Consortium, and you'll see they have a link that is likely trackable. It's a short link, so they can see how many people click on it. They have tagged the American Association of Museums, and so therefore the National Association of Museums may see this post and re-engage with you. And then the link, so there is, you know, a touch point for your audience to click on it, learn more, and stay engaged. And then another one that I posted on the right side, which is about today's event. So I mentioned HP, I mentioned New Media Consortium, and social media with a link to today's webinar. So we've been thinking about content, so let's just talk briefly about searching, measuring, scheduling. What are the other tools that can help us manage social media to make our lives easier? And so there are so many tools out there. It depends on your preference. Tools like Hootsuite, Social, Radian 6, and TweetDeck can help you manage multiple accounts and search for relevant messages. This is just a screenshot of TweetDeck, which is a tool that I use to manage multiple Twitter accounts. You can set up columns and search for certain terms. So for example, you want to know whenever someone's tweeting about education, you can include a search column for hashtag education or hashtag edtech. And anytime someone tweets about edtech, you'll see it and you could possibly retweet it, repost it. You might find someone new to follow that you're interested in. You can also create columns for the Twitter handles that you're managing for your organization and monitor whenever someone's tweeting at you. That way you never let a message go unresponded to. And I know that Hootsuite recently integrated Google Plus into their platform, so that's an exciting development and hopefully saves a little bit of time so that you don't have to log into three different places to share information across channels. And so do some research and see if you have multiple channels that you're managing, if there's a tool that will work for you to manage multiple channels and save you some time. That being said, I'm still a fan of trying to make sure that each message is shared effectively across channels. So for example, hashtag doesn't have much weight in Facebook. And so if I connect my Facebook and Twitter accounts and I have hashtags on my Facebook page, it doesn't have the same meaning as it does in Twitter, where someone can click on the hashtag and get information. So just make sure that you're thinking about the best way to share your messages across tools, and then look and see if there are tools that can help you manage those accounts all at one time. And I think that was a lot of information in a short period of time. I think that's my last slide, but I would like to give anyone the opportunity to ask questions. I don't know that I saw them as they were coming in, but I would love to answer some if there are some questions. Okay, I'm seeing a few on the right. I'm going to go ahead and answer some of them. The first one that I'm seeing is, I did mention linking multiple social media channels. I have not actually tried the Hootsuite Google Plus tie-in yet, so I cannot speak to whether or not that works or how to make it work better. How many social media sites should you be using? To me, it's a good rule of thumb is, you know, use what you're comfortable with and use what you have the bandwidth to manage. If you have video content or if you can create video content, consider YouTube or Vimeo. There are lots of different tools you can use. Facebook and Twitter are major ones. There are just major audiences there, so I think those are great ones. But again, also it's good to know what your audience is using. So if you're in a project potentially with maybe an older audience, it may be that they have a preference in a certain tool. So get to know your audience and maybe get to know where they are, what channels they're using when you decide which ones to use. Google Plus, I'll touch on really quickly. It's different from Facebook in that it's tied to Google. Also, one of the major ways that Google Plus and Facebook differ is that Google Plus was developed with the idea in mind that you can control who you share information with. So Google Plus is based on circles versus, you know, you add someone to your circle versus liking someone on Facebook. And you can create different circles. You can create different groups within your audience. In the personal world, the idea is you have a family circle, a friendly circle, professional circle. And so therefore, if you want to send a message out, you can send it to just your family circle or just this part of your audience, maybe just your staff. And so there's a big privacy benefit using Google Plus, and one of the things that they had in mind when they built it, to my knowledge. Google Plus also has Google Plus Hangouts, which are video conferences such as these today, but they are free for up to 10 people at the same time. They recently launched a feature where it can be broadcasted on YouTube so that a broader audience can still watch it, but you only see 10 faces in the room at the bottom of the screen. Also, I really like their video interface. Their photo interface. I think it's very clean. I like the way that videos and photos and posts are presented. And lastly, I'll mention you could use Google Plus as a way to post a longer form article, somewhat like a blog post, because their posts are not limited in length. Or if they are, it's a lot longer than 140 characters and a lot longer than the Facebook limit. And so if you don't have a blog or you don't have the capability to blog, Google Plus may be a great way for you to share longer content on one topic and then post a link to that on your other social media channels. Also, Google Plus has an added search engine optimization benefit since it is related to Google. If you have a Google Plus page and you include content with keywords about what your project deals with, you may have a higher return when someone is searching for something in your industry, your page may come up a little bit higher. I can't guarantee that, but sometimes that can be the case because it is related to Google, and it's another presence that you can have that is searchable in Google. So some things to consider about Google Plus.
I was going to say, Rebecca, we do have a question from Tanya.
Okay.
How can I get folks in, and is there a way to invite from organization page directly?
I'm sorry, how do we get folks in to...
I'm thinking it's Google Plus. Is that correct, Tanya?
I believe it's actually a Facebook group that she was referring to.
Got it. Okay.
Tanya, can you clarify folks into?
Is there a way to invite particular folks in from an organization into a Facebook group?
To a Facebook group.
That are maybe following your organization's Facebook page.
On a Facebook group. I'm not sure. I have to say I'm not sure. The first thing I would do is post a link to the group on your page and say, we started a private group or whatever the purpose of that group is. Please, please request to be added and we will add those who are, who fit their requirements. That would be the first thing, is to post it on your Facebook, on your business page, that you have the group and post a link to it or let them know the name of it to search for it and be requested to be added. I don't know if groups may be tied to individuals, and so therefore I don't think you can invite individuals, but do not quote me on that. I do not know how large this audience is, and I am not a spokesperson for Facebook, so I am not entirely sure. But I believe groups are tied to individuals, not businesses, and so therefore I would post a link to the group and promote it that way and ask your audience to join.
And Rebecca, this is Samantha. That is my understanding too.
Okay, perfect. The difference between a Facebook page and a group is a Facebook page, anyone can like the page. It's more public. The group is more private. Usually you have to invite individuals, and I don't know, you might be able to make a public group as well, actually. The Facebook page has the capability to create events. The group may also, the Facebook page you can tag other businesses from. I don't believe you can do that with a group, but you might be able to.
Yeah, and actually just to add on to that, for the purposes of HB Catalyst members, if you were to create a Facebook page for your organization, it would be kind of your public identity, where you post general information about your project, upcoming events and needs, et cetera. But with a Facebook group, you could start a conversation around a very specific subject. Let's say your students are needing some help with their business math homework outside of class. A Facebook group you know, would a private Facebook group would allow them to type questions to you privately, where only the students and you can see them.
And I would say if you were going to create a group, the best benefit is to have a private group. The way she's mentioning is, I belong to a group, an organization that we have members, so we have paid members, and only paid members are allowed into the group. And we have really great discussions in there, just about our topic that we're all interested in, and we get knowledge from each other. Sometimes we post opportunities in there, and it's a really great way to foster relationships within your specific membership community versus the broader community. So I think a group can really be a powerful way to collaborate. The Facebook page has a little bit more sharing and public capabilities. And the last question that I'm seeing is how Twitter lists work, and Twitter lists are simple ways to, well, they are ways to organize your followers or those that you're following, actually. So you can look at your list of those that you're following and add a list, include, you know, students, educators, volunteers, for example. You go to each individual and you can add them to a list. And then you can make the list public, so you can let your audience know we've created lists. Feel free to follow our volunteers, for example. So it's another way to aggregate all of those that you follow.
Hey, Rebecca, a quick question. Can you record a Google Plus Hangout? I know a lot of our NMC members, for example, use Google Hangouts.
You can record it. It goes to YouTube. So if you have a YouTube restriction, I think there could be a challenge there, but you can. So I'm not sure if it's actually a record button. I think it is, and so you can, I believe you can record it and it goes to YouTube, is my short answer. I can confirm that. I believe that's true.
I was just going to say, I saw a question from Lisa talking, having you maybe talk about the timing of posts.
Like time during the day?
Yeah, maybe pushing them out at specific times, if I'm speaking to that.
Sure. So there are lots of reports out there that say what are the ideal times for posting are. I would say because we have a large audience here, it definitely varies across countries and across the world. Personally, for me, it's about my audience. So if my audience is, you know, they're in school and they're college students, then maybe they're up late at night. So maybe posting at night is not out of the question. And so it's getting to know your audience. Maybe it's a little bit of trial and error and testing to see when you get a lot of response. But to me, it's more about audience and what you have to share. I'm a big fan of posting during business hours, just because I think most people, I can't say that, but in my world, a lot of people that I'm communicating with are on those channels, mainly during business hours, maybe after business hours, or with the family, if they're networking or doing other things. But I think, you know, the one thing about social media is it's around the clock, 24 hours a day. When I first started using Twitter, I had trouble sleeping because I thought I was going to miss some exciting and important information. So get to know your audience, do a little trial and error. There are tools that can tell you, I can't think of the name off the top of my head, that can tell you the ideal posting time for your audience once you're up and running. But again, it depends on, you know, if you're doing an exciting launch, maybe you do it first thing in the morning. Or if you want to lead up to a launch, maybe throughout the day you post some, you know, some hints and some sneak peeks, and then at 4 o'clock you launch it. So I think, you know, it depends on your content, it depends on your audience, but just be aware, be conscious, and pay attention to those times.
I think that's a really great point.
I'm sorry to interrupt you, Sam. I have Cheryl from UW-Madison say, is there a resource that lists all the social media tools and how they are most likely to be used?
I don't know of one. Samantha, do you know of one?
There's definitely great resources on specific tools. I don't know if there's a resource that lists them all together, but I would definitely recommend checking Edudemic. They always have up-to-date articles and descriptions of interesting ways to use social media for educators.
And another question, can a group member see your personal information on your regular Facebook account?
That's a great question. So if you're interacting, let's say, Lisa, I know that question came from you with your students in a Facebook group. If you're if your specific profile, your privacy settings are so that people who aren't friends with you can't see your information, then not even the students in your Facebook group will be able to see your profile or information.
And then we actually had another question from Lisa. Do you need a special program like Hootsuite to time the posts?
Yes. Well, for Facebook, no. For Facebook, they just launched that you can, recently, that you can time posts. You can write them and then schedule them for later. If you're looking for it, when you're typing in the post section on Facebook, look just a little bit below that in the same post window. There's a little clock symbol, and that's where you can time it. For Twitter, I'm not aware of a timing function in the native Twitter, but I do believe TweetDeck. I know TweetDeck does because I use it, Hootsuite as well. And the others do. So unless someone knows otherwise, in the actual native Twitter, I don't believe they have a scheduling tool yet.
And I also want to mention, just while we're talking about Hootsuite and TweetDeck, we also use a tool called Social Oomph. So as you're growing your followers on Twitter, you want to interact and connect with them more personally. Social Oomph has a feature where you're able to, when you get a new follower, automatically send a welcome message to them. And you could create many different types of welcome messages and kind of interchange them. So if you're working on a very special promotion for your project, like you're putting together a special event, you could have the message that goes back to your new followers to be specifically about how they can get involved in that event.
Well, that was an incredible list of questions from the participants, so keep them coming. Thank you very much, Rebecca.
Absolutely.
Thank you, Rebecca. And for the sake of time, I'm just going to skip ahead a little bit because I want to talk a little bit about what's coming up next. So what would a workshop be without some homework, right? And a campaign to come. So for the HB Catalyst members that are in the audience, now that we've talked a little bit about social media basics, we want to task you with making your own Twitter and Facebook pages as homework. And I know that could seem a little daunting, especially if you don't have a personal page yet and you're not familiar with using the tools, which is why we're here to help. So we've talked a lot about Facebook and Facebook groups today in this workshop, and we've created a specific Facebook group to answer your social media questions as you begin to build your Facebook and Twitter pages. And that Facebook group can be found at go.nmc.org/social-media-help. Which is a short link for a much longer Facebook URL. And in there, you could ask questions in real time as you're setting up your account, and someone will from the NMC will be answering you, which is really exciting. Or if you happen to be on Twitter and have a quick question in 140 characters or less, you could ask your question and tack on hashtag HBCatalyst at the end of it. We'll spot it right away and be able to send an answer to you. So again, that's go.nmc.org/social-media-help or hashtag HBCatalyst on Twitter. And we'll talk a little bit more about that campaign in our next workshop, but you got to be there to hear about it, so stay connected and stay tuned. Our next workshop is actually taking place next month, September 26th, and we've talked about building your social media identity, and so hopefully you'll be far enough along with your Facebook and Twitter pages where you'll have some efforts to measure. So we'll be talking about using and applying social media metrics and actually measuring your social media efforts. You could sign up at any time at go.nmc.org/catalyst-social-media. If you have any questions about this workshop, an upcoming one, burning questions about social media, I'm Samantha@nmc.org, and you could find me via email. So we really look forward to seeing you at the next September 26th workshop and also on the Facebook social media help page for the HB Catalyst workshop. We look forward to seeing HB Catalyst members, what you can accomplish with building out your Facebook pages and your Twitter accounts, and we'll stay tuned. And I, again, want to thank our fabulous presenter today, Rebecca Otis from LocalizeAustin, for enlightening us all about sharing and creating great content. Holly Ludgate, a wonderful host and a terrific asset to the NMC. And of course, we give a tremendous thanks to HP and HP's Office of Sustainability and Social Innovation for making all the work of the HB Catalyst Initiative possible as well as this series of workshops. And thank you to the fabulous attendees who've kept those great questions coming. And do keep them coming long after the workshop in Twitter and in Facebook on the HP Catalyst social media help group, as well as the HP Catalyst Facebook page, which is facebook.com/HP Catalyst.